Now we will move on to our next session, oration, and I want to call upon stage our chairpersons, Dr. R.S. Majumdar, Dr. Anjan Lal Dutto, Dr. Shomitra Kumar for this session. And I want to request a oration on Sushila Bala Kundu, three sliders, and after that we will start with Dr. P.K. Dev. Now I want to request Dr. R.S. Majumdar to hand over the medal to our beloved Dr. Pradeep Kumar Dev. And Dr. Shomitra Kumar, please can you hand over the flowers to Dr. Pradeep Kumar Dev?
Late Sushila Bala Kundu was the mother of Dr. S. Kundu, the renowned cardiologist here, who was also the president of the West Bengal branch of the CSI and held important post at the All India CSI. And is one of the pioneer cardiologists of India. Sushila Bala Kundu died in August 1992 at the age of 80 years. This lecture has been instituted by Dr. S. Kundu since 2000, dedicated to the memory of his mother. And every year we have a renowned cardiologist doing the job. And this time it is Dr. P.K. Dev, past president of the Cardiological Society of India and a renowned cardiologist of India, a dynamic leader in the field of cardiology and organizing CSI at the All India level. Dr. Dev, please. I have pleasure in presenting before you Dr. P.K. Dev.
Thank you. Thank you for the kind words, respected chairpersons, and my friends. Cholesterol and statins, some facts, some myths, a story is being retold from a different viewpoint. Cholesterol first discovered in 1816. In 1913, Russian endoscope in St. Petersburg in Tsar Military Hospital induced atherosclerosis in rabbits by feeding them with cholesterol for 4 to 8 weeks. The journey begins. This is the evolution of cholesterol epidemiology. We have several evidences that high blood cholesterol level induces atherosclerosis and cardiovascular mortality. Those initial forgotten days, initial non-statin experience with psychosis, and other forms of death, but with 4S trial of a flagship trial in 1994, the statin era begins, that cholesterol lowering reduces cardiovascular mortality, morbidity, and also all-cause mortality. So the cholesterol kinetics, it has expanded. Hepatic cholesterol, dietary cholesterol, biliary cholesterol, recycling of biliary cholesterol, reverse cholesterol, brain cholesterol, placental cholesterol, and lastly, de novo cholesterol synthesis in each and every cell of the body. In this connection, I want to tell that after 60,000 years of evolution, each and every cell of the body can synthesize cholesterol, but each and every cell of the body do not synthesize essential amino acids, do not synthesize glucose, but it can synthesize cholesterol. That means it is necessary for the survival of each and every cell of the body. This is the lesson from 60 million years of evolution. So lipidology beyond the LDL cholesterol, high LDL cholesterol, HDL more than 60 is an independent negative risk factor. LDL more than 80 is not beneficial at all. There is a J-curve. Small dense LDL-C, highly atherogenous, genic, and also LDL pattern, it is called also LDL pattern B. It can be measured directly as LDL particle number or as ApoB or non-HDL-C. Dyslipidemia triad, highly atherogenic. Triglyceride, fasting or postprandial hypertriglyceridemia this atherogeny. Postprandial production of triglyceride-rich lipoprotein remnants makes this hypertriglyceridemia atherogenic, LPA atherogenic. Now, triglyceride-rich LDL cholesterol, the ugly stepsister of LDL cholesterol, these are all atherogenic substances beyond LDL cholesterol. Now the cholesterol synthesis. Cholesterol is synthesized in the body from acetyl coenzyme A through the mevalonate pathway, ultimately the cholesterol. So where from acetyl coenzyme A comes? It comes from oxidation of glucose, it comes from oxidation of fatty acids, it comes from oxidation of amino acids, ketogenic amino acids, it comes from oxidation of alcohol. So it is not in the monopoly of free fatty acid oxidation that acetyl coenzyme is produced and ultimately cholesterol is produced. Cholesterol can be produced from glucose, ketogenic amino acids, free fatty acids, and also from alcohol. So by restricting fatty acid intake, we don't restrict the synthesis of cholesterol in the body. Now dyslipidemia, the physiological role of cholesterol. Cholesterol is an essential component of cell membranes and membranes of subcellular organelles, endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi, mitochondria, lysosome, nucleus, endosomes and peroxisomes, everywhere. Cholesterol furnishes the substrate for steroid hormones, vitamin D and bile salts. Cells tightly regulate their cholesterol content, each and every cell. Cholesterol synthesis is the metabolic regulator through oxysterols. So we need cholesterol for the function of the body cells. So before declaring a patient as suffering hyperlipidemia, the secondary causes should always be excluded, we know it. Now the hepatic cholesterol, the synthesis depends upon the presence of LDL cholesterol receptors, HDL receptors, LRP, PCSK9, and cholesterol synthesis itself within the hepatocytes. It is a tightly regulated biomechanism, uptake through the receptors, receptor upregulation, downregulation is there, rate of synthesis within hepatocytes, rate of biliary excretion, and rate of intestinal absorption. Everything is interrelated and everything is an active process. Now, the brain cholesterol, our new knowledge. Brain is the most cholesterol-rich organ along with liver. It contains about 20% of the whole body cholesterol. 70 to 80% of cholesterol in the adult brain is in the myelin sheath. Rest is made up by cell membranes of astrocytes and neurons to maintain their morphology and synaptic transmission. Neurons have large amounts of membrane surface of their actions, dendrites and synapses, including presynaptic vesicles, where significant type cholesterol is detected. Brain cholesterol, it is called a long secret life behind the barrier. What is the barrier? Barrier is the blood-brain barrier. Cholesterol cannot cross the blood-brain barrier. So de novo synthesis of cholesterol occurs in the brain cells in variable amounts through a different biosynthetic pathway, which may or may not be inhibited by statin, probably. So cholesterol kinetics in brain. Cholesterol cannot cross the blood-brain barrier. So where from the cholesterol comes? De novo synthesis is the main issue. And then the cholesterol is converted to 24S hydroxycholesterol, which can diffuse through the blood-brain barrier into the brain cells. And also, a mechanism of compensatory elimination of excess intraneuronal cholesterol through conversion into 27-hydroxycholesterol also exists, which can diffuse out through blood-brain barrier. But most of the cholesterol in the neurons is synthesized de novo. Now, placental cholesterol. Placental barrier is impermeable to cholesterol. Then where from the fetus gets the cholesterol then for its growth? Fetal side of the placenta can synthesize cholesterol. Trophoblastic cells express LDLR, LRP, SR, and SRBB1. Fetal cells can synthesize cholesterol to variable extent. Umbilical cord vein has higher LDL cholesterol than umbilical arteries. So fetus can produce and synthesize its own cholesterol through fetal cells. So accumulating evidence regarding dietary cholesterol and saturated fat. Intestinal cholesterol. Cholesterol is absorbed from the duodenum and proximal jejunum. 1/4 of intestinal cholesterol comes from diet, rest from bile, recirculation. Intestinal mucus regulates the amount of dietary and biliary cholesterol that enter into the body, active mechanism. Cholesterol absorption is controlled either by Niemann pick protein or cholesterol transporters like ABCA1, ABCG5, or ABCG8 in the intestinal mucosa. Cholesterol absorption from the enterocytes depends upon Niemann pick cell, and ezetimibe inhibits this Niemann pick cell and inhibits absorption of cholesterol from the enterocytes. Dietary cholesterol has little impact on blood cholesterol. I repeat, dietary cholesterol has repeat impact on blood cholesterol. Dietary cholesterol consistently increases HDL cholesterol. Cholesterol absorption from gut is an active process through Niemann Pick protein. Dietary cholesterol reduces circulating small dense LDL particles also. Now the Harvard X study, it was done by Harvard School of Public Health. Each and every patient of heart disease were given to take 1-2 cholesterols daily, and no extra incidence of cardiovascular morbidity or mortality could be detected. So then several changes came. Is it bad to eat red meat? Your diet and heart disease, rethink about butter, beef, and bacon. A new US guidelines, limit intake of sugar, but rethink about cholesterol. So what are the new US dietary guideline? It removes restriction of total fat and sats and limit for added sugar. It censors existing conclusions of scientific advisory committee. Does the evidence support a limit of 300 milligrams of cholesterol per day? No, it doesn't support. It revises dietary cholesterol recommendation now because cholesterol intake more than 300 milligrams per day is now recommended. Few fundamental questions. Can cholesterol be good or bad bearing the same chemical structure? Can bad cholesterol say LOX cholesterol, OX cholesterol, MOX cholesterol, or glycated cholesterol? OX means oxidized cholesterol, MOX means minimally oxidized cholesterol. For which activity of HDL cholesterol, HDL should be appreciated? For carrying dietary cholesterol from enterocytes to the hepatocytes, or for carrying oxidized cholesterol from the peripheries to the hepatocytes? Because HDL does both. So HDL is at the same time is a good cholesterol and also a bad cholesterol. So cholesterol X and revised dietary recommendation. Recommended daily intake of dietary cholesterol for the average healthy person is above 300 milligrams per day, according to Heart and Stroke Foundation of Canada. Not applicable for diabetics with heart disease. US government is poised to withdraw a long-standing warning about cholesterol. Cholesterol in the diet need no longer be considered a nutrient of concern. 3 eggs per week, including yolk of the egg, are approved. Restrictions of exercise has also been loosened. Now, PO study recently published in 2017, what is the result? High carbohydrate intake was associated with higher risk of total mortality, whereas total fat and individual types of fat were related to lower total mortality. Total fat and types of fat were not associated with cardiovascular disease, myocardial infarction, or cardiovascular disease mortality, whereas saturated fat has an inverse association with stroke. Global dietary guidelines should be reconsidered in light of these findings. Now, biliary kinetics. Cholesterol derived from reverse cholesterol transport via scavengers is channelized to bile from hepatocytes to biliary tract and gallbladder for intrahepatic circulation. Oxidized cholesterol, hepatocytes, biliary canaliculi, bile cells, intestine. Transmembrane transporters like ABCA1 and ABCG1 are active in this mechanism. Considerable amount of free cholesterol is converted into bile acids and lost in the feces. This mechanism plays an important role in regulating the percentage absorption of dietary cholesterol. Unique biofeedback mechanism in the body. Overexpression of ABCG5 and ABCG8 promotes biliary cholesterol secretion and reduces functional absorption of dietary cholesterol. Dietary cholesterol suppresses hepatic HMG coenzyme reductase activity and enhances fecal excretion of bile salts and cholesterol. Biliary cholesterol secretion also depends upon reverse cholesterol transport. When hepatocyte synthesis of cholesterol is reduced or suppressed, PKSK9 is increased. Exploring evidence with moderate dose statins. Initial statin trials, 4S, CARE, and Lipid. Look at it carefully. Moderate dose statins were used. Baseline cholesterol was 188, 139, 150. LDL change was -35%, -25%, 27%. Major coronary events were reduced, including coronary mortality. If we calculate, the LDL cholesterol was reduced up to 105 or 120, not below 100, but excellent results were seen in these cases. Now, explaining evidence, high-dose statins. High-dose statin in chronic CAD and unstable CAD. Look at these sites. High-dose cholesterol in stable CAD. TNT and IDL. 152 baseline cholesterol, 121. LDL change was equal to 4 study, 35% or so. Major coronary events are reduced, but there was no impact on total mortality. So if moderate dose statins without decreasing LDL cholesterol below 100 can cause all-cause mortality, and high dose statin by reaching to a LDL cholesterol target below 100 cannot reduce all-cause mortality, remains a mystery. Disappearance of mortality benefit with high dose statins in chronic stable angina is unique and has been overlooked surprisingly. People say that at the time when Forest study was done, standard of care was not available. Now the answer is very simple. When Paradigm study was done in heart failure, it did wonder in presence of standard of care. Same is true for EMPEROR outcome and Canvas study. It did wonder with standard care. Odyssey study, it did wonder with standard care. Then why not TNT and IDEAL study? The molecule, the strength of hydrostatin, there is some inherent weakness in that dose. So-called lower is better trial, cholesterol could be lowered below 100, be up to 70, 60, but without any impact on total mortality. Hydrostatins in unstable angina, miracle, Proviton, A to Z, no impact on total mortality. Proviton, no impact on total mortality. Now, critical review of hydrostatin intermittent cardiology. No robust evidence so far directly, only extrapolation, no direct study. Routine pretreatment with hydrostatin. Pretreatment should be considered in elective PCI and in non-STL elevation ACS. Pretreatment before primary and direct PCI for STEMI requires further study. Pretreatment effectively reduces risk of contrast-induced AKI. Clinical benefit can be achieved in interventional cardiology by low-dose statins also. Early pleiotropic statin benefit is not noticed in high dose only. It could be noticed in low-dose statin therapy as well in coronary circulation. Evidence, Apollo study, 2.5 to 5 milligrams of rosuvastatin. Real study, 5 to 25 milligrams of rosuvastatin. In a few cases got 20 milligrams. There are excellent results. So, interventional cardiology and hydrostatin, there is no monopolic association between the two. Statin benefit in ACS, we know it. Let me still state. Reduction of periprocedural MI with routine pretreatment, it is there. Reduction of recurrent ischemia, rehospitalization and targeted vessel revascular, it is there. Additive benefit in reduction of early coronary stenosis acting along with DES, it is there. Now the coronary intervention and statins. Coronary intervention is a different ballgame altogether. There is iatrogenic catheter-induced injury over and above spontaneously occurring plaque injury to different pathophysiological processes altogether. Hydrostatins and also DES is unlikely to be a magic bullet in catheter-induced trauma. Extrapolation from non-PCI trials are not acceptable as preferred treatment strategy. Injuries and inflammation during coronary intervention, we know that spontaneous rupture and fissure plaques, trauma of guide wire, trauma of dilatation, trauma of stent deployment, trauma of non-absorbable metallic start on coronary arteries, hypersensitive reaction to the durable polymers. All these things are doing the harm there. Now the anti-inflammatory drugs, what are being used in coronary intervention, hydrostatin, stents or scaffolds and hydrostatins. Let us see what happens. Inflammation and proliferation are necessary for healing and repair everywhere. And by using this drug-eluting stents in the drugs and hydrostatins, we are interfering with this inflammation and proliferation. And that means we are interfering with the process of repair at the same time. The suppression means suppression of healing and failure of endothelialization. So by using this drug-eluting stent and hydrostatins, endothelialization also being inhibited. Result, the reduction of early coronary reduction, yes, resistance, yes, but precipitation of late, and very, very late stent thrombosis. Result, indefinite use of DAPT with its complications. This is our experience from RAVEL, ABSORB 3 and ENDEAVOR 4. The issues, what are the issues? The drug eludes from days up to 3 months. Drug and its effect may sustain in vascular tissue for some time more. Thereafter, the strong anti-inflammatory and anti-proliferative action of hydrostatin may play adverse role in endothelation along with hypersensitivity reaction to polymer and metals. Constant remains about the risk of late, very late and very, very late stent thrombosis along with very late stent failure. Beyond pleiotropic benefit, now I come with PCSK9 inhibitors. Beyond pleiotropic benefits of statins, where we can get aggressive LDL cholesterol lowering. 4-year trial with PCSK9 in stable coronary artery disease, no mortality benefit, even when LDL cholesterol could be reduced below 25 milligrams per cent. ODC long-term trial in ACS patients, LDL cholesterol could be reduced below 25, maybe up to 15. Mortality benefit, all cause, what was the primary endpoint in this study, but some peculiar results has been achieved. I have discussed that thing now. Look at it, the ODC trial, all cause mortality, in composite endpoint study, there's only 6% benefit. P value is 0.026, not that significant. If it is now post hoc analysis, LDL cholesterol was broken into three segments, below 80 to 100 and above 100. Below LDL cholesterol, no improvement in mortality benefit. When PCSK9 inhibitors were used in LDL cholesterol level below 80 to 100, no mortality benefit. But when PCSK9 was used in a group where LDL cholesterol was more than 100 after using maximum dose of statin, there was excellent mortality benefit. So it gives us new issues. The composite primary benefit is there. Observation from ODC. Initial moderate dose statin trials like 4S, CARE, etc., LDL cholesterol was reduced to 102 to 123 milligrams per cent. There was significant all-cause mortality, reduction of fatal and non-fatal MI. And subsequent high-dose statins, LDL cholesterol was reduced to 70, 80 milligrams per cent, no all-cause mortality benefit, but reduction of non-fatal MI. ODC experience, if we just couple the two, in ODC, with LDL cholesterol of 100 to 70 to 100, in spite of maximally tolerated dose of statin, all-cause mortality benefit was insignificant. But in patients with LDL cholesterol above 100, in spite of maximally tolerated dose of statin, significant mortality benefit was noted. We need to analyze and learn from this data. We need to reanalyze the data from earlier moderate and high-dose statin trial in stable CAD. Now, PCSK9 inhibitors have a dichotomy in its activity. Differential effects of PCSK9 variants on risk of coronary disease and ischemic stroke. It can reduce coronary events, but it has no impact on ischemic strokes. Now I come back to the initial slides, 4S and CARE, where the HDL cholesterol reduction was achieved up to in 4S up to 123, and CARE 102, where we get significant benefit of all-cause mortality. In TNT and IDL, cholesterol with high-dose statin, cholesterol was reduced to 70 to 80, no benefit on all-cause mortality. So real world scenario is human biological system has its unique mechanism of de novo synthesis of cholesterol since fetal life. Each and every cell of human being needs cholesterol for its structural integrity and metabolic regulation. Only hepatocytes can synthesize cholesterol is a myth. Body cells create cholesterol in amounts much larger than the diet provides. Few teasing informations regarding statins based on evidences. Low-dose statin, high-dose statin, all-cause mortality. You look at the trials and studies. High-dose statin, high-dose statin do not impart any all-cause mortality benefit. High-dose statin answers issues of concern. Statin and primary prevention in women. Study material is still very poor. Statin and its side effects, particularly with hydrostatin, it is there. Statin and cytochrome P453A4, the interaction is there. Statin and cancer, there are some evidences in PROSPER, TNT and CARE. Statin and cerebral hemorrhage, there it is there in from SPARKLE experience. Statin in new diabetes, established. Statin and mortality benefit, hydrostatin, no mortality benefit. Statin in ischemic heart failure, no evidence. Statin in octogenarians, very scanty evidence. Statin in major surgery in sepsis. After major surgery, we need proliferation and healing. statin interferes with proliferation and healing. Statin and maintenance hemodialysis, no effects. Statin in Asians do not tolerate high dose of statins, and Asians do wonder with low dose of statins. Statin and coronary intervention, we use it, but evidence material is very poor. Statin and antibiotic prescription, when using with azithromycin or clarithromycin, we should be careful while prescribing statins. Now the final comments. Initial moderate dose statin trials established moderate benefit in stable CAD. Subsequent high dose statin trials in stable and unstable CAD failed to establish all-cause mortality benefit. In ACS, pleiotropic high dose statin benefit is visible within 16 weeks. Not an all-cause mortality, but hospitalization, restenosis, recurrent ischemia, there is benefit up to 16 weeks. Beyond 16 weeks, high dose statin, what is its purpose? It is not known. Pre-procedural hydrostatin has excellent impact on reduction of procedural MI up to 4 weeks. We need prospective randomized trials and data registries to optimize the appropriate dose and duration of statin in coronary intervention. Dietary cholesterol has no impact on blood cholesterol. Body creates cholesterol in amounts much larger than the diet provides. Dietary cholesterol need no longer be considered a nutrient or concern. The carbohydrates should be restricted. Cholesterol is beneficial for health. Inappropriate high cholesterol is detrimental for health. The partition between health and disease, so far as cholesterol is concerned, has not been clearly defined. The lower is better is not based upon evidences, so far as LDL cholesterol is concerned. The higher is better is not based upon evidences, so far as statin treatment is concerned. Absence of mortality benefit of PCSK9 inhibitors in optimally lowered LDL cholesterol with statin is disturbing. But presence of mortality benefit with the PCSK9 inhibitors in optimally lowered LDL cholesterol in suboptimally lowered LDL cholesterol is not disturbing. In suboptimal LDL cholesterol reduction with statin, PCSK9 inhibitors induce mortality benefit. High dose statin therapy has no impact on mortality, but moderate dose statin therapy has definite impact on mortality. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Dev. Your detailed illustrated program and lipid profile has enlightened us very much. Thank you. I don't think I will ask you any question. Let my coach help.
As usual, all lectures by Dr. P.K. Dev is very thought-provoking. He has given us enough food for thought. So we should analyze each and every statin and PCSK trial, PCSK9 trial with greater depth now before we come to our prescribing habits. So with that, and I'll ask my senior co-chair, Professor Dr. to please give the concluding remarks.
Remarks are never concluding, neither final. So you have opened up a new, brave new world, statins and lipids. So let us look forward to future trials and see.
Yes.
We'll remember your comments. Thank you very much for a thought-provoking lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. P.K. Dev, and thanks a lot to all our chairperson, Dr. R.S. Majumdar, Dr. Anjan Lal Datta, Dr. Shomitra Kumar.